Welcome into episode 24 of the Sources Say podcast, your go-to Kentucky basketball and recruiting podcast on the growing KSR podcast network. I am your host, Jack Pilgrim of Kentucky Sports Radio, and I am happy to be joined once again by two of the best up-and-coming recruiting insiders in the game, Travis Graff of Cats Illustrated and David Sisk of Cats Illustrated. Travis, how are you doing today, man?
Doing fantastic. Glad to finally have the gang back together.
Absolutely, yeah. We'll get into that, how things unfolded here in a minute. But real quick, David, how are you doing, man?
Let me take Las Vegas, Boston Garden, College Basketball Hall of Fame. No, I'm sorry. I'm just talking to myself about all the places Jack Pilgrim's been to here in the last couple of months.
Yeah, so it has been absolutely chaotic. So, last week I went up to the Boston, the Massachusetts area. I went to the HoopHall Classic to get things started last weekend, 2 weekends ago. I don't remember the specific weekend, but went up to the HoopHall Classic, got to see some of the UK signees and major targets in action. And then I went, I took the little trip over to Boston to go see the city a little bit, went to two Celtics games, got to tour Fenway Park, did a bunch of the, as you guys have heard on this podcast several times in the past, I'm a diehard Boston fan, so I wanted to get up and see one of my favorite places and my favorite
teams. Did you learn how to steal signals?
No, I did not, actually. That's hopefully the – in fact, during my tour of Fenway, they were very kind of there was definitely an animosity in there about how things were unfolding and how they were not happy about what was going on in the national media and all that stuff. So it was an interesting, very, very interesting experience. I loved it. I very lucky that I actually came back, because I'm one of those guys that could very well see myself ending up in Boston long term at the end of the day. Obviously not now, but several years off into the future, that might be something I explore. But I'm a very, very big fan. I had a lot of fun. But the only reason why we didn't record while I was up there is I couldn't bring the equipment up there. They, as you guys may have seen on KSR and on social media, the Matt, Drew, Shannon and Ryan, they all went up to Iowa. They drove to Iowa and they took the podcast equipment with them to do these little nightly shows. So because I was getting back Friday, they were leaving before I was able to get back, so I couldn't bring the podcast equipment up there with me. So my options were either no show or record it with like voice memos or like the voice recording app that you have on your phone. And I just kind of thought, the content might still be okay, but I just think the audio quality would have been too poor, and I just didn't want to risk that. So that was the reason for our week off. I apologize for that, and hopefully we will be able to make up for that this week with a jam-packed episode with lots and lots of information. And we'll get started with what I saw up in that area with the HoopHall Classic, guys. That is one heck of an event. If you guys can ever make it up there to in the area to see it, that's one heck of an event with so much talent across the board, not just with Kentucky guys, but just so many talented players, guys that are going to various high major schools. There's just a ton of talent up there, but more specifically the Kentucky guys. Lance Ware played, BJ Boston played, Devin Askew played, and just in terms of the actual signees, Terrence Clark was supposed to play, but I think weather kept them out of that event. They had to stay home. I think it snowed pretty bad when they were trying to make the drive, so they had to call it off. But like Jonathan Kaminga's team, he didn't play. He's dealing with an ankle injury. But his team was there. Cade was there with Scotty Barnes, with Montverde. Just a ton of talent. It was just an absolute blast. Before I go on my kind of tangent on what I saw in particular and what I liked about the Kentucky guys and all of that stuff, I know both of you guys kind of mentioned that you kind of watched from afar. You watched the highlights. I think Travis, you said in particular, you actually streamed some of the games. Real quickly, you know, Travis, what did you see from the Kentucky guys in particular, including the targets that they're going after right now? What did you think of what you saw?
First thing that stuck out to me was I think Lance Ware could help the team this year. He's not the flashiest guy, but he's gritty in the paint. He's physical. He won the matchup against the now number three ranked player, previously number one ranked player, Evan Mobley, who is considered to be a Sherlock top five pick in the NBA draft at some point. And absolutely, he's throwing him around in the paint, out hustling him to every loose ball, to every rebound. Just he put up some nice stats in that game and really held Evan Mobley at bay. Devin Askew, I don't think he had a great game. Kind of like Kristen Peek said last night on Cat Scan podcast. She said that he didn't have a great game, but you look up and he still got 20-something points.
Oh, yeah.
And I was kind of like Ashton Hagans this year. You don't – Ashton Hagans, there's some games you're like, oh, he's playing like crap. And you look up, he's got almost a triple-double.
Yeah. What was that one stat line he had, like 16-9-9, and everybody was like, wow, this is one of his worst games as a Wildcat. And you actually look at the stats, it's like, oh, wow. He
plays down the stretch, and then you get the stat card at the end of the game. It's like, holy crap, he was two stats away from a triple-double. Everybody's in the press box like, eh, he's not doing too great. And,
oh, yeah.
But and then non-UK related, Jalen Green really stuck out to me. He's phenomenal. Mont Bird would be a top 50 college team. I feel like they're just outrageous,
unbelievable.
And Cade Cunningham is deservingly the number one player in the class.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, their whole starting five is just absurd. BJ Boston continued his tear and it showed in the new rivals rankings. He's now up to fourth, which dropped Terrence Clark down to fifth. I'm sure we'll get to that later in the show, but. Yeah, BJ Boston's been on an absolute menacing tear over the past couple months, and the HoopHall Classic was no different.
Yeah, absolutely, David. What did you see, and whether it was the highlights or actual live stream from the UK guys in particular, and just anybody else that stood out to you?
I didn't watch as much of it as Travis. I'll be honest with you, I'm not a huge film and video watcher. Now, when I get a chance in person, I'll really do it. I seem like I pick up a lot more in person than I do on film, and it's been it way over the years. So I just enjoy doing it more. You kind of have an idea, though, when you watch these guys. You can tell if they're bigger, if they're stronger, kind of how their game is developed. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess the guy, Lance Ware, has been a guy that I've kind of enjoyed watching a little bit, because I'm going to be honest, I didn't get to see him a whole lot in spring because at that time Kentucky wasn't on him as much.
Yeah.
So just kind of see first impact. How is he different than what you thought in the past? It's like Travis said, he plays with so much energy, and you kind of watch these guys and say, well, are they Calipari's type players? How could they help now? And Lance Ware is that kind of guy. BJ Boston, ever since last spring when I knew Kentucky was really on him, and we all did, that was a guy that we watched intently, and he's just somebody that I've really enjoyed watching. And I wanted to see him with the ball in his hands a little bit more than he did with AOT, because Sharif Cooper was playing a point. And, you know, I've told you, I was kind of jealous of you, Jack, because you got to see him in Charlottesville he was actually had the ball in his hands playing point. And just kind of watching how his game's grown. And we're going to get into rivals ratings a little bit later in the show. But I think we all knew that he was going to make a major, major jump. We didn't realize how much, but I mean, he's obviously, you know, I know Travis Royce, Jalen Green, and Cade Cunningham, they're on a very high level, but BJ Boston's playing his way into the elite of the elite conversation.
Yeah, I think that's one of the biggest takeaways. He played two games up there, BJ Boston did, and both games he brought something different to the table than what I had seen from him in the past. And that was kind of something that that I was really impressed with was I've seen his intermediate. I've seen his mid-range jumpers. I've seen the step-back threes. You know, I've seen that every time I've seen him. But I was almost kind of hoping to see something new out of him, something that I hadn't seen in the past. And I thought he was much more active defensively, trying to jump the passing lanes, wanting to get out in transition, push ahead. You know, he had that massive poster dunk that made SportsCenter top 10. You know, I was wanting to just see something else, and he did bring that to the table. I mean, that's not to say that he didn't provide that same scoring. I think he had 17 in the first game and 20 in the next game. But I mean, he's just has such a diverse game, brings so many different things to the table in terms of just pure scoring. His ball handling, I think, is just so impressive for his size. You know, a lot of guys that are as tall as he is, I mean, and the more I see him, I think he's a true 6'7", pushing 6'8", not, you know, a lot of times they give you an inch or two in the
Christian official height. On the CAT scan last night said that when she talked to Brandon Sr., that he told her that that BJ had grown an inch or an inch and a half since the summer.
Yeah, I hadn't heard that, but yeah, that does not surprise me at all. That's exactly what I was thinking. He is pushing closer to 6'8" than he is 6'6" or 6'5". That, you know, sometimes they give you an extra inch. You know, a lot of times they give you an extra inch or two in the official official numbers on the various recruiting outlets. But he is not one of those guys. For how tall he is, and kind of, I mean, honestly, how lanky he is. I mean, he's not bulky at all. That's something that he's still going to need to work on. But for how tall he is, his ball handling ability, and just how fluid he is, you know, as the kind of primary guard option. I mean, it's something just that really, really impressed me. That kid, we talked about it when we kind of ranked every single player in the class. I think it was 2 weeks ago. Yeah, 2 weeks ago, or maybe three, whenever it was when we did the top 25 rankings, I kind of left him. I think I put him at 8, I believe, and I didn't know if I was selling him short a little bit, but just because of how much of a jump it would have already been to put him into the top 10, I know he was down to 14 on I think it was Rivals, maybe down to 17 on ESPN, whatever it was. He had dropped a little bit, and I wanted to give him the credit he was due by putting him in the top 10. But I didn't know that they would actually give him that top 5 ranking. But it was not something that when I saw that, I thought, oh wow, that's way too much of a jump. That was one when they put that out there. I was like, you know what, he has earned it. He has separated himself as like David, like you said, as one of the elite of the elite, and he is deserving of that 100%. Lance Ware, great point.
Let me ask you this. I'm sorry.
Go for it.
Having seen them in person, I know the thing that struck me last spring and summer, I saw Dyke, Jalen, and BJ in back-to-back games. And I'm like, that's the same from a build-wise. It's the same guy. Now, at that time, Jalen was more explosive. BJ had better skill.
Mm-hmm.
But their height and weight and the way they were built, I'm like, man, they're like twins.
Yeah.
Is that still the case? Is one outgrown another? Or
yeah, I definitely think BJ Boston's taller than Jalen Green. But yeah, I mean, those two are just such different players and what they bring to the table. So it's kind of tough to compare those two. But size wise, yeah, they're spitting image of one another. Just except I'd probably give what's Jalen officially listed at 6'5"? Maybe
6'5", I believe.
Yeah, I think he's officially 6'5". But yeah, I definitely give BJ a couple inches at the very least. But. Yeah, I was very, very impressed with what BJ brought to the table. That kid, I know I'm going a little overboard with the rankings and talking about that, because we're going to get back into that here in a little bit. But I was kind of surprised that they went as far as moving him ahead of Terrence Clark. I don't know if I would. Again, you know, I was hoping to see Terrence this weekend, but or last week, and they didn't show up, so I couldn't compare the two of them based on my own two eyes. But it was kind of ballsy of them to give BJ that extra push, but he has led one of the best high school teams in the nation in scoring. He is the best player on one of the best high school teams in the nation. So, I mean, you got to give credit where it's due. He has earned that ranking 100%. Real quickly, Lance Ware, Travis, like you said, he absolutely bullied Evan Mobley in that matchup. That was something I've never really been. I heard some rumblings this. I can't remember if it was in the summer or maybe early fall that a lot of the people on the West Coast were not very pleased with Evan Mobley and kind of how he kind of ducked major competition at times and wasn't putting himself out there to prove that he was among the best of the best, that he was kind of just, you know, using the old film and all that to kind of solidify his status as one of the top recruits in the nation. We weren't able to really see that over the last several months. So my first time seeing him in person at this event, I was not impressed at all. I really, as he was matched up with Lance Ware, I was like, dude, these players are comparable. I mean, and I'm more so saying because Lance is a top 35 player in the country and Mobley is the consensus top 3 player in the country, he's been rated number 1 for forever. So to see them matched up against one another, I really did not see a significant difference between the two. I think Lance bullied him down low, was throwing elbows, kind of, you know, working his way, trying to create space in the paint, and he just had his way with him. I mean, he literally just created space at will against arguably the best big man in high school basketball. And
it's an old corny saying that hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. Because you watch Lance Ware next to Evan Mobley, and you can tell Lance Ware is not the fastest, most athletic dude on the court, but he was completely outworking Evan Mobley, and Evan Mobley has otherworldly talent compared to Lance Ware, if we're going to call a spade a spade.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's a great
point. Lance Ware is somebody you want in your program.
And what's so funny about that is when you think of this year's team and what Calipari has been preaching over and over and over again regarding, you know, the just toughness, being physical, being just trying, getting players that, you know, don't rely on just pure talent or pure athleticism or just, you know, their natural abilities. He has been begging this current team to just show fight, show effort, be a workhorse. And yeah, you bring up a really good point about, you know, just, you know, work out, you know, outweighs talent. That's exactly what we saw, and that's exactly the type of player that we are hoping to see this season. And Kentucky fans should be very, very excited about that in itself. He's gonna I think I talked to his head coach. I'm working on a KSR post right now about it, but I kind of asked, okay, what are Kentucky fans getting out of Lance Ware? And they were like, and he said, it's actually Jalen Brunson's dad. He said, guys that are hoping for a 20-10 type player are going to be they're going to be disappointed. That's not who he is. He might score 20 points. He might grab 10 rebounds in a game, but that's not who he is on every, you know, any given night. He doesn't care about stats. He's a guy that cares more about doing whatever it takes to win the games. He's going to be a guy, okay, if Calipari says we need somebody out there that's going to grab a bunch of rebounds, he's the guy that's going to raise his hand and say, all right, I got you, I can be that player. If he says I need somebody to, you know, dunk the ball 5 times and outwork this elite big man down low, he's going to say, all right, I got you, coach, I got you. That is the type of player that Lance Ware is. Talent-wise, he is a very good player. I wouldn't say he's a great player. I wouldn't say he's an elite player. I think the talent is, you know, on that's where is why he's ranked where he is. But in terms of effort and tenacity and what he brings to the table, that's what separates him from the pack, and that's why he separated himself against arguably the best big man in the nation. That was a really, really telling matchup that I really that was very, very impressive on that end.
David, you're closer with the guys than me with the guys who do the rankings for Rivals. Do you think that game in their eyes against Evan Mobley solidified giving him the last 5-star in the class?
Yeah, it definitely didn't hurt. And there'd been a lot of talk out there about the improvements that he was making. Anyway, I think that's a definite possibility and a good point that you brought up. And I'll tell you something to go along with that. You know, Evan was back and forth with Cade Cunningham for a long time, the number one player. But early on, everybody thought that Evan Mobley was the number one player in the class, hands down. And I was going to say, as a young player, it's kind of like going into a presidential campaign a year before the first primary or caucus, and you're up 20 points, and you've got the target on your back. So they get to take shots at you for a year and lay you down. And I think being 15 years old and told that you're better than everybody else in the country, it's not even close. That's kind of the worst thing that can happen. So not only does Ware get that last five star, but also if you notice, Jalen Green passed Mobley for the first time in the rankings. So I tend to think that might have a big impact, that matchup, because not only did Ware get that fifth star, but Mobley dropped.
The last signee, Devin Askew, he dropped 20, I think it was 20 points, 9 assists, 7 rebounds, and 3 steals. So, like, yeah, I mean, he absolutely just loaded the stat sheet. I mean, he brought everything to the table, kind of like BJ Boston. I've kind of, you know, I've said over and over again, he's a game manager. He's the kind of guy that can lead your team to a national championship. You know, might not have the natural ability of, you know, natural skill as some of the other point guards in the class, but he's going to compensate with that in terms of his toughness and fight and all that. But I was kind of watching closely, you know, with his defense and kind of watching him off ball and seeing how he communicated with his team and how, you know, kind of the stuff that you don't see on a stat sheet or stuff that you don't see on the highlights. I wanted to see what he did outside of when he has the ball in his hands. And he's the kind of guy that is going, even when he's outmatched physically, you know, the guy that's bigger than him or stronger than him a little bit, he's going to be up in the grill of, he's at least going to be an annoyance no matter who he's going up against. I remember in EYBL, I can't remember who, he went up against a really strong, tough, he went up against Cade in the EYBL, and he, you know, just got right up in his grill and was not making anything easy for him in the final Peach Jam. I think it was the semifinals, I believe. And he made nothing easy for Cade. And that was something that really kind of caught my attention. And that's what, especially this weekend in particular at HoopHall, he was just nasty on the defensive end. He was trying to jump the passing lanes and really just getting up in people's space and making life difficult and just being uncomfortable for the opposition. That just really, really impressed me about him. And I think he had a little bit of a
cold. Watching him, let me ask you this, watching him warm up and shoot warm ups and then during a game, in one game especially, we heard a lot earlier in the year, and this is when Kentucky wasn't shooting well, was that he's a point guard, but he's really got a great outside shot too. You know, that was really something that appealed to Kentucky fans at that time. How pure did his stroke look?
Oh, he has – and what makes me think that it's going to translate well to the next level is that muscle memory is 100% there. It's a very fluid, you know, not a lot of, you know, no hitches, no, you know, weird kind of, you know, Michael Cape Gilchrist type stuff where it, you know, your shot, your elbows changing every time you lift for your shot. There's none of that with his shot. It's just a very pure, you know, fundamental shot that you know, I think it's going to translate to the next level 100%. I mean, he didn't have the best shooting day in particular. I don't have the exact numbers in front of me to see what the efficiency was, but he did miss a lot of shots that I've seen him make in the past. But the form's there. The foundation of his shot is 100% there, and I was talking to his dad a little bit after the game, and he was saying, man, what's going to be so, you know, impactful at the next level when he has BJ Boston and Terrence Clark and whoever else they get, you know, he's going to have so many more opportunities where he's going to find himself open on the perimeter, where he's going to be able to, you know, kind of the defense is obviously going to be focused in on the two top five guys in BJ Boston, Terrence Clark. And, you know, if they end up getting Greg Brown or whoever they're able to get, you know, because of that, it's going to allow Devin Askew to be wide open and, you know, on the perimeter, whether it be in the corner or you know, wherever that is, he's going to have his opportunities to make shots. And, you know, that's something that's exciting them because they know the pressure is not going to be on him. They know, you know, they're realists. Like, they understand that you know, Cade Cunningham is probably a better point guard than Devin Askew, and that there are other better point guards in the nation than Devin. But they know that he can combat that natural talent with the intangible stuff that you look for in a winning point guard, and that's why they're so excited to get to Kentucky and be surrounded by such elite talent and you know, kind of get the attention off of him a little bit. He's been leading that modern day offense and you know, he's been kind of the focal point of that team. Now he's going to be able to go to Kentucky with you know, two of the best guards in the class. Maybe they get a Greg Brown. Maybe they get a you know, a major grad transfer. Whoever it is, there's going to be more talent around them that kind of highlights them and kind of creates opportunities for Devin because of that. So yeah, I was very, very pleased with everything I saw from all three of Kentucky's signees. We're not going to go too much into the other guys. Cliff Omarui, I mentioned this on Twitter. I told you guys behind the scenes. He is a guy that I think could give you 10, 15 minutes on this current Kentucky team right now. What we talked about with Lance Ware, same thing you get from Cliff Omarui. He's a guy that if there are three things he does well, and that's the only thing he brings to the table every time he steps on the floor, it's that he's going to create space for rebounds. He's going to, you know, at least put himself in position to rebound the ball. He's going to rebound the ball, like actually rebound the ball. And he's going to dunk shots or you know, dunk balls. He's going to be a cleanup guy. He will do that every single time he steps on the floor. And he's going to block shots and bring intensity every time he steps on the floor. That is who he is as a player. He you know, his game has developed a little bit offensively. He's still a little bit raw. You know, the skill is slowly developing, but it's still not 100% there. But you could get, you know, you can guarantee what you're going to get out of Cliff Omarui every single time he's on the floor. And that's just effort, intensity, rebounding, blocking shots, and dunking the ball. I mean, that's literally who he is as a player. And that is something Kentucky could desperately use right now. Love his game. I am very, very, very happy with him. I would love for him to be kind of the fourth big in this class. I think that would be just absolutely terrific. Other guys of substance that Kentucky fans would care about, Brandon Huntley Hatfield in 2022. I think Kentucky is, and I don't want to say a lock, but I think Kentucky is a runaway favorite at this point in time. He is physically dominant. There's no reason that he needs to spend two more years in high school. He's a guy that I think 100% is going to reclassify, should reclassify, and is going to thrive in the class of 2021 if he so chooses. And I think if he does do that, he's going to end up at Kentucky. Musa Diabate, I thought he was very, very impressive. I don't know what I don't know if he's a Kentucky guy, because I think they have other guys in the class of 2021 that they're higher on in the front court. But I was impressed by him. Jairus Walker, another IMG kid, he was impressive. But DJ Wagner, guys, I'm telling you, if he doesn't go to the NBA by the time, because he's a 2023 kid, he may go, the one and done rule very well may be over by then. That's a kid that Kentucky fans need to watch out for, because he is a Kentucky lock if I've ever seen one. And that's a kid that is already taking the high school basketball world by storm. He is damn good. I'm telling you right now, he is very, very talented. The skill that he has, just his knack for scoring and how he's just able to find easy opportunities to score. It's just unreal. It's very, very weird seeing a kid as young as he is. You know, like, he's Bronny's age, and everybody's hyping up Bronny and what he brings to the table, and, you know, the kind of the circus that comes with being LeBron James' son. But DJ Wagner is three times the player Bronny is right now. I mean, DJ Wagner is the truth. He's going to be a very, very, very impressive player in the next several years. And if the one and done rule is not over by then, or still in place by then, and he just decides to go the college route, he is going to be a Kentucky Wildcat. I'm pretty darn certain of it, and that's going to be a big get for Kentucky when that time comes. So moving on from the HoopHall Classic, we already talked about it a good bit, but let's just kind of close things out in terms of just this segment with the new rivals rankings. Terrence Clark came in, he dropped a little bit and kind of got replaced with BJ Boston. BJ Boston's now number four. Clark is number five. Let me see the other rankings. I know Kentucky had...
Give me just a second. I got them saved right from yesterday.
Me too.
Boston four, Clark five, and you got...
Askew 26, Jackson
27, and... Cameron Fletcher was 41, I believe.
42. Lance Ware is 32. So basically, Kentucky has two top five kids. They have four top 30 kids ish, 20 or 35. Four top 35 ish kids, and then all six are top in the top 50. I guess all six are in the top 42 since Cameron's in number 42.
And five of the six are five stars.
Right. And that's kind of that's the biggest takeaway, is that they are very, very high on Lance Ware after this latest jump. They were very, very impressed by him. So that's definitely impressive. Real quickly, David, give me your overall takeaway with the rankings and you know, do you think BJ deserved to make the jump over Terrence? What do you think about Devin and Isaiah's ranking? Do you think Lance Ware should have jumped that high? Do you think Cameron Fletcher deserves to be where he is? What are your just overall takeaways real quick?
I tell you what, I would hate to have the job of doing the rankings.
Oh, yeah.
I think everybody can sit, this guy's too high, this guy's too low. And to me, it's about like criticizing referees. You know, if you get out there and have a whistle in your mouth, it's a whole different ball game. And it's really tough. Like, you get in, for example, you know, with Lance and I, excuse me, not Lance, but Devin and Isaiah. And if you'll take a look, you had some guys that like Earl Timberlake, some others that basically they just traded spots. If you look, you know, Devin, I think, dropped four spots, and there were four guys right behind him who moved up one or two. So they're just exchanging spots. And, you know, I've heard, we're talking with Eric Bossy a lot privately, and he's like, man, people get tore up about a guy being ranked 14th. He said, do you know what the difference is in a guy being ranked 14th or 15th, a guy being ranked 8th? And he's like, there's not one. He's, you know, they're just, you know, basically, you know, 12 of one, a dozen of the other. Mm-hmm. So that's not to me. And I did the story, put it out last night on the new rankings. And I said, look, don't worry about Isaiah and Devin dropping a ranking. You know, Terrence drops one, BJ Boston moves up in front of him. So I think fans would be pretty pleased, you know, if one's got to move in, that it's BJ. And I think fans are really pumped up over BJ making the top five. And then, you know, Lance Ware getting that fifth star. So I think all in all, those rankings are something that Kentucky fans can be very, you know, pleased about. And I think as it goes into the spring, they had players, you know, I've already done a story months ago that this was by quantity and quality one of the top two or three classes already that John Calipari's had at Kentucky.
Yeah.
And now when it's even better now, because at that time BJ Boston was in the teens And Lance Ware was a 4-star. So, you know, it's even went up from there. So, I mean, overall, this is, you know, a tremendous class. And, you know, it looks like it's only going to get better.
Absolutely. Travis, give me your overall takeaways, the good and the bad.
Overall takeaway for me is, pulling up the rankings right now, there's a few moves that I really agree with. BJ Boston moving up. I was surprised he went up all the way to 4. I thought he'd be in like the 6 to 10 range, but I'm definitely not going to be mad about that. I like where Scotty Barnes is at, and I like how Jalen Suggs moved into the top 10. I still think Jalen Johnson is arguably a top 5 player. That there's just some behind the scenes stuff going on where, and he hasn't played for IMG and ended up transferring back to Nicolet, so not really getting too much film on him. I wholeheartedly agree with Isaiah Todd's fall, down from 10 to 14. Talked about that when we were ranking him before. He hadn't shown me too much and tries to be a guard too much. And I love that Caleb Love is now the third or the fourth ranked point guard in this class. I really like his game a lot. And like, I forget if it was Eric Bossy or Corey Evans said that everybody in the range from like 26 to 32 is all interchangeable. And Lance Ware ended up coming in at 32. And he said that they just made the executive decision to give all of them 5 stars just because they're so comparable.
Yeah.
And I see Cliff Amaru was a big jumper as well. He moved up 19 spots to 36.
Yeah, was he the second biggest jump of any player?
The biggest I've scrolled past so far.
Yeah, I think
18. Somebody fell 21 spots.
Somebody in the 70s.
Monty Wilkinson from Bishop Gorman jumped 55 spots.
Yeah, from what to what?
It's got to do math. 133 to 79.
That's the one. Yeah, he was the guy that was mid hundreds to the 70s that I saw. In fact, that was the guy that
That was a guy that I asked you about because Vanderbilt's in his top 4, and I did some work with Vanderbilt as well. And he was in during his top 4, and I asked you about him. If you'll remember, I sent you a text, and you said, "Man, if Kentucky wasn't if he wasn't a Kentucky signee, I didn't really pay attention."
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. That's a good eye for you. I was really had no idea that they played Cliff, I believe. I think they play Roosevelt Catholic.
They did.
So I was watching the game just 100% for Cliff, and then when you texted me that, I think it was like an hour later. I was like, shoot, I have no idea. And then I looked up his ranking. I was, at the time, it was like 130 kid. I was like, oh shoot, dude, I have no idea. I wasn't even paying attention. So you hit the nail on the head with that one. That was
I'll tell you another one, just to give you an example, while we're just kind of small talking on it. Terrence drops, and sometimes, you know, it's kind of goes hand in hand with what you said maybe about Brewster, not getting a chance to talk with him.
Yeah.
And the whole Brewster thing this year, you know, they've not been out there. You've not seen a lot because I asked, a teammate of his is Jamal Mashburn Jr.
Right.
And who has signed with Minnesota. And I asked Corey last night, I said, can you give me just the most recent, if you've seen him in the last few weeks, the most recent scouting report on Jamal and something that's not a couple of months old. And he says, look, I've not got to see it. And, you know, Brewster's just, you know, for to have guys like Terrence Clarkson, they've not been out there. And you look at Sierra Canyon and BJ, man, they're, you know, they've got national analysts looking at them every week. And I think they've got to see BJ and his consistency. He's just done it over and over and over and over. And they've not got to see Terrence. So, you know, BJ, I think when it gets, you know, who's better, well, we've got to see BJ more this winter, and he's done it. We've not got to see Terrence, so, you know, we're going to go that route. Now, I think sometimes that has a whole lot to do with it when it's just from exposure aspect of it.
Yeah, that's an absolute. It's definitely a great point. Yeah, I don't know. We weren't recording when we were talking about the Terrence thing, but during my Boston trip, I was trying to get in contact with them and go do a recruiting profile up in New Hampshire. I think it's like an hour and a half drive up from there, and it was very difficult to get in contact with them. It's like Brewster is a boarding school, so I don't know if it's because they want to be structured, not let a lot of media in, and kind of keep it, you know, keep those the gates closed as much as possible. Even with a top five talent that they have. So it was very difficult. I wish I was able to get in contact with him, but we're still working on a phone interview. Shoot, maybe we'll be able to get him on. I'll be able to use that phone interview for this podcast next week. But that's the goal. I'm trying to get in contact with them, but it's difficult. Well, with that, why don't we – I was going to talk a little bit about Khalil Whitney and his transfer decision, but David has to jump off first between the three of us. So let's get into – I asked for some questions on Twitter, and we got a ton of good ones. So I just wanted to get to those real quickly and let David have an opportunity to answer some of those. So let's go to that. First question. Well, this kind of ties into it. So this comes from Chris Adams. So did the Whitney family just pull up with a U-Haul last Friday or just a big pickup truck? So obviously a lot of people want to know about this Khalil Whitney thing, so we can at least just touch on it briefly before you hop off. Travis, what do you know about the Khalil Whitney transfer and how it all unfolded? You can say what you want. You can withhold whatever information you want to know. I know we talked before that there's some stuff you don't want out there, but I'll give you the open floor to say what you want.
I've heard behind the scenes that, well, for one, he wasn't really necessarily going to class. He was missing workouts and stuff. Wasn't really necessarily his decision. It was people around him, his circle, his AAU coach, his parents. Just to name a couple, I've heard that from different sources, and yeah, I think his hands were kind of tied, and I think it comes back to he was improperly ranked and improperly scouted by Kentucky last year. He had no business ever being a top 10 or top 15 player. He is literally Cameron Fletcher, and I think Cameron Fletcher is going to have a more impactful freshman season than Khalil Whitney did, because Cameron knows he will not be a one and done. And that he will, I think Cameron will buy into the rebounding and defensive stopper role.
Yeah.
In a backup role. He's not going to be called upon to do too much next year with the firepower UK will have at the wings. But I think that's the role that a lot of people have implied that Khalil Whitney refused to take.
David, do you know anything about Khalil Whitney's decision to transfer? And if not, kind of what do you think it means for the team moving forward?
Well, I think as far as the team goes, that got answered Saturday. I don't even think they had to circle the wagons. I just think sometimes there's addition by subtraction. And I know this. I think anybody that's played sports, it doesn't have to be basketball. It could be Little League baseball. When you have somebody that's not totally bought in, you know, even though you're having a good game, things look like are going well, you're always watching that guy out of the corner of your eyes. It's like you're never free. Mm-hmm. And I think we saw Saturday that you have players that they've totally bought in. I think that, you know, even like with Johnny Juzang, you know, he moved up from that ninth guy to that eighth guy.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've been wondering about him. Well, he surpassed him. I don't know if that was the last straw. I don't know. But I think it's a team now with players embracing the roles. They're playing for each other. They play hard. I thought Saturday, in the toughest of circumstances, man, they got after it. That was a big time game, a tough physical battle. And, man, this team's going to be just fine without him. Unless, you know, you hope there's not an injury that might delete depth, but you know, it's not a grand slam that even if somebody got hurt, well, I wish we had Khalil Whitney, you know, we wouldn't have to worry about it. Well, you may still have to worry about it.
Yeah.
You know, he may not have played any better. If you look at his numbers from the Louisville game on, I mean, I want to say, I had written this. I think he had something like, gosh, maybe 4 points in 7 games or something like that. So, I mean, you know, that's you're not going to miss much from that.
And his box score plus minus was like really deep in the negative. And something
Kyle Tucker tweeted that, and my mouth, I remember my jaw hitting the floor when I read it. It was like maybe plus or minus in the last 77 minutes was like minus 33, or it may have been the other way around. The last 33 minutes over minus 77. But
yeah,
it was just a crazy number.
Something else I'd heard behind the scenes was that a few players had kind of pretty much let it be known with Khalil to either get with it or get lost, essentially. Like, they're tired of his attitude, the way he was handling things. And like I said, I don't think all that's Khalil's fault. I think that he was given a bad direction by some people. But, yeah, I think that a couple of players that had it with some of the stuff going on with him.
Yeah. One thing I don't want, you know, to kind of get out there is – I don't want it to seem like Kentucky pushed for this transfer. You know, that there was so much tension. Because what I will tell you, there was tension inside the locker room. I think that there were, you know, as Travis kind of hinted at, like there was some tension about his work ethic and kind of you know, the overall like general consensus was that he came into Kentucky assuming that he was going to be a one and done and kind of carried himself as a one and done and kind of went to class like a one and done and kind of carried himself on the practice floor like a one and done. And it was something that rubbed people the wrong way, whether it be players or coaches. You know, I don't want to get into specifics with that, but it rubbed people the wrong way and people called him out on it. I don't know if that kind of jump started the, okay, well, if you don't, you know, if you guys are going to call me out on it, then maybe I don't even need to be like, I don't know if that's how it unfolded, you know, kind of the step-by-step process. All I know is that there was some tension and it was not good. And there was also some difficulties on the other side of it with people, like Travis said, people close to Khalil that were in his ear quite a bit telling him that he was better than he actually is and that he wasn't getting enough opportunities. And that kind of – there was just that dynamic. It was just clutter, 100% clutter, that added to it. If he like Travis said, if he had realized, okay, maybe I wasn't ranked correctly, maybe I am a two-year player, maybe, you know, if he had understood his role and kind of accepted it as it is instead of, oh, shoot, as soon as I get in the game, I gotta jack up a shot every single time I touch the ball. Oh, I gotta just try to get mine. You know, if he didn't have that mentality, then it probably would have unfolded better than it did. But it did not. I don't want to say it was an ugly breakup, but it was something that
Like you said, Kentucky definitely did not want this breakup. Kentucky was all for him returning, all for working everything out. And I've heard that from multiple people. And I thought it was funny a minute ago, you were talking about all the things he did like a one and done. He did everything like a one and done except play like one.
Yep. And I think in his mind, he thought that the reason why he wasn't playing like a one and done was because he didn't have the opportunity to play like a one and done. And it was just, there's just so much back and forth, just behind the scenes stuff that it just didn't work out. I think it was a bad, I'm going to, you know, put it out there that I think it was a very bad decision. I think he could have at least, I don't mind the decision to transfer if he really doesn't want to. I still think he's going to end up just going pro. I still don't know if he'll actually end up transferring. But I just think it was a bad decision. I think, I like the kid. I respect, you know, I understand where he's coming from in terms of wanting more opportunity and all that. If I had that ranking and I came in and I didn't get the opportunity that was handed to me, I'd probably be a little upset. But there has to be some leeway with it. There has to be some push and pull with it. You got to at least provide that effort to at least show that you deserve those opportunities. You know, there's a lot of stuff that went on behind the scenes, and it's just a difficult decision and situation all around. I wish him the best.
I spoke to an individual yesterday who's very experienced in these kind of things. And he told me, he said, Khalil a year ago had a million options, and he has cut his options drastically.
Yeah.
If a lot of what's being said is true, you know, he's cut them down. You know, I know that John Calipari, you know, I've read where he told him, he said, look, if this is what you're going to do, you better succeed. I hope you do. And you better succeed because, you know, he's definitely going about it with to leave at the end of January. I mean, he's definitely going with it through a very unorthodox approach.
Yeah. Yeah, it's there's really no positive to this decision at all, unless his end goal is to enter the NBA draft, which he will not get drafted. Like, I mean, there's nothing he could do that would show that he would get drafted at this point. I think the best route for him would be to transfer to a team like Illinois, where he could get, you know, if he's a guy that just wants shots, then go to a place where he can get shots. Go to an Illinois. Go to a Georgetown. Go somewhere like that. He can do that at several of the, you know, still a high major, but not a blue blood program.
Well,
he can do
Brad
that.
Brad Underwood doesn't seem to me like a guy that's going to coddle.
Yeah. I mean, that's he, like, you bring, I mean, that's a really good point. I mean, he probably burned a lot of bridges by quitting on this team midway through the season. Cause that's exactly what he did. Maybe like this Vandy game, this could have been an opportunity for him for Kentucky to get a, you know, 15, 20 point lead early in the second half. And Calipari basically go, all right, Khalil, this is your time. You wanted minutes. You're playing the rest of the game, whether you're good or bad. Make sure this team doesn't sink. Let's try to get you in here and get minutes. This would have been the perfect opportunity for him, and he decided to quit before he could even get that chance. You know, it's just very, very difficult, very, very tough. Wish him well. It just didn't work out, and that's all right. We'll see how that unfolds. Real quickly, David, while we're on this topic, I know you talked to some people up in the Northeast. Some people asked, in fact, while you're talking, I'll see exactly who asked the question. But people asked about whether or not this decision affects, in fact, we'll say Kentucky Blue 4L says, do you think Khalil's departure could affect Omarui's decision? And, outside of that, maybe Jonathan Kuminga or other guys in the Northeast, do you think this affects that decision? Or, you know, Lance Ware and his decision to already, you know, sign, does this affect that at all?
I talked to several people in the New York City and New Jersey area yesterday who have knowledge of certain recruitments, and even talked to Clifford's guardian and Muhammad Oliver. And I'll start with his conversation. And let me say this all together. I was amazed at how much I didn't have to drag anything out of it. It was like they wanted to talk about it. And Clifford's guardian Muhammad told me, he kind of laughed. I said, look, I hate to ask a question like this. I know it's a tough one. And he laughed and he said, man, I thought you were going to ask me something bad or something hard. He said, that's the easiest question he'll ever ask me. He's like, this has got no bearing whatsoever. He made the decision. Khalil made the decision he had to make. And Clifford will make the decision that he had to make. And yeah. He said, they are friends. So let me say this, from talking to them in the past, I don't think, obviously, they play at Roseau Catholic together, but I don't think that that's going to be an issue where they're going to be best men at each other's weddings.
Yeah.
I think they had a player relationship, but and they're friends, but I don't think they're, you know, best friends. And Coach Calipari, too, has done a lot of clinics and stuff at Roseau Catholic. So, you know, he's raised, doing that's helped raise a lot of money for that school. So I think there's probably, and you never know, maybe it has been tainted by this, but I think there's still that good relationship with Roseau Catholic and Coach Calipari. And definitely, I don't think it hurts with Clifford from what they told me. But I also talked with some people around the New York City area that are well known and who know these players, and they said this, and they're right. And let me say this, John Kuminga and Lance Ware are not in a situation where they're that tight with Khalil Whitney, and they're going to listen.
Yeah.
And, they said this, they said all of these players believe that, hey, let's say, and he said, I tell guys all the time, look, If you go to Kentucky, you go to North Carolina, you go to Duke, you go to Kansas, they're not going to stop recruiting. They're going to just because you signed, they're going to keep bringing players in. And it's a battle for competition every day. And his statement was, and he's right, these alpha players always think, and it's what makes them special, well, that's not going to happen to me. No matter who they bring in, they're not going to beat me out.
Right.
And that's true. That's what they believe. And he said, so a John Kuminga, a Lance Ware, that's not going to faze them. But like I said, besides that, they weren't that close anyway. And then he also talked about, he said, and I knew this, there were over 800 players in transfer portal last year in Division One. And you think about it, out of 353 teams, out of 13 scholarships, you know, you're looking at roughly, I don't know, maybe 4,500, 5,000 players in all, and that's counting the seniors. There were over 800 Division I transfers. And so, you know, Duke, North Carolina, Kentucky, these are not the first guys to transfer.
Right.
You know, and it's not hurt them. They keep getting players. So, in a nutshell, you know, I've been assured, and I believe it 100%, that this is not going to have a negative impact. And one guy told me, he said, look, the only problem it could cause is that if Khalil or somebody around him, family member, whatever, really were upset about this and had a vendetta against Kentucky and wanted to talk some players out of it. But from you know, people that I've talked to that are close to these guys, you know, I don't think they would give it much of a listen anyway. So I just don't see much coming out of it.
Well, David, do you have to go anytime soon? Or
yeah, I probably need to run here, man.
All right. Well, Travis and I will stay on, but David, we appreciate you jumping on with us
hey, no problem.
And talking with us. We'll be back with you next week.
Sounds good. And hopefully here in the next few weeks, man, if I can make it through November and not have a breakdown, February, and get this thing over with during the season. I knew it was going to be hectic right now, but I appreciate you guys working with me.
Absolutely. No problem at all, man. We will have you back on next week, and we look forward to it, man.
Okay. Sounds good.
All right. See you, buddy.
See you, David.
See you, Travis.
All right. And now – wow. Travis, we can just keep on running through these questions if you want. Does that work?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, brother. All right, well, let's just rapid fire this thing. From our friend Jimmy Williams, our favorite. The dude is awesome. We love him to death. He asks, do you think Richard's recent transformation would give Montgomery any hesitation to stay one more year? I will answer that quickly. I am here to tell you that the staff went into the season assuming that no matter how it unfolded, that both players would be gone. In fact, on Richard specifically, I think Calipari said on his call-in show on Monday, he said something along the lines of Nick Richards is going to graduate, and kind of slid in the fact he said he's going to graduate and something, something, something before he goes to the NBA. So I don't know if he meant to, you know, be as blunt as he was and kind of admitting that Nick is already penciled in for the NBA. But if you're watching him play right now, it's very obvious that he's going to the NBA no matter what. He is, you know, I would argue he's SEC Player of the Year right now. So that's a done deal. But regarding Montgomery specifically, Travis, what are you hearing with that?
I still lean Montgomery leaving, but I think that Richard's transformation alongside him in the post would give him more incentive to return than he had coming into the season. I think, like you said, I think at the beginning of the year that people around Kentucky's program penciled him in as somebody that was going to be gone regardless. But I think toward the end of the season, I think you're going to see a different side of EJ Montgomery. I still think he's going to turn it on for a stretch of games and just show some upside. And gun to my head, I think he leaves.
That's my exact thoughts on it. I think, yes, he's – and I think Calipari said even in that call-in show, he said, we're getting like 6-minute runs out of him where he plays like flawless basketball. He's rebounding. He's, you know, boxing out. He's being tough. He's you know, hitting some tough shots. He's starting to, you know, have these little tiny short spurts of greatness. But he was like, you know, we'll see 6 minutes here, and then 20 minutes he'll either be on the bench or just be in the game and not play well. And then like 6 minutes at the end of the game, he'll go, oh shoot, you know, the team needs me to turn it on, and I'm going to turn it on for the final 6 minutes. And then he'll start the game really well, end the game really well, but the time in between he will be completely invisible. And Calipari said that is what we are focused on. He was like, man, we're getting about 6 minutes right now of really, really impressive play out of him. If we can even push that to like 20 for right now, just get us to 20 as our first stop, then we'll talk from there. And I think the staff is kind of betting on EJ to take that next step up, because I mean, like we saw against Texas Tech, he had really, really impressive his start to the game. He was phenomenal. He was doing everything right on both ends of the floor. He just kind of turned invisible there for a while. And I think the staff is betting on him finding that consistency for, you know, longer stretches than 6 minutes at a time. I think that they're banking on him becoming that player that that we kind of thought he would be going into the season. So that's kind of where I am with them. I agree. I think Kentucky, until I'm told otherwise, I think Kentucky's going to lose all three of EJ, Nick, and Nate at the end of this year. And they will have to replace them accordingly. Well, this is kind of vague, but Cullen McElroy says, if you had to predict the most likely scenario with this class closing out, who would it be? Travis, be real vague with this, and then we'll because some other people talk about players in particular. But real quickly, how do you think the class ends?
I think they had two more bigs, one being a grad transfer, and the other one being either high school senior or a high school reclass.
Okay, well, if you're going to say that, who do you think that option could be? Maybe not grad transfer, because that's a little bit early.
Yeah, grad transfer, nobody will know until the spring, really, who's going to pop up on that radar.
But give me your one high school guy.
Reclassification. I know UK is working hard at getting Paulo to reclassify.
Good. That's what I want you to say.
Option 1A, and that's I think the way I understand it is UK's biggest wants right now are Paulo and a grad transfer down low. And if those two don't work out, I mean, of course they would take a Greg Brown, but gun to my head, I don't think Greg Brown comes to Kentucky.
Okay.
Cliff Armory could be an option. Frank Kepnang could be an option, despite his guardian telling me that he wasn't going to be a reclassification candidate. Not questioning what he was telling me in any way, but you know how that stuff goes.
Yeah.
And plus, people on UK's side are like, hey, this could be a guy to watch out for. So.
Right. Yeah, I would I'm going to go ahead and say they get Paolo. I know I've been going back and forth with when he does come. I've said on the last several episodes.
I think it'll be Peach Jam.
Yes. Yeah. I think it'll be Peach Jam. I've been saying over the last several episodes that I think he's going to end up at Kentucky no matter when he goes. And I don't think it's a done deal. I'm not saying, oh, he's a Kentucky lock no matter when it happens. Kind of like I was saying with like DJ Wagner, guys like that, or, you know, Brandon Huntley Hatfield or anything. But as of today, I think Kentucky is the leader, and I'm going to go ahead and say, because of how hard they're working at it and just playing the odds, I think there's going to be a day that Paolo realizes, you know, after talking to Devin Askew's dad this last week and talking to him about the reclass process and kind of what the pros and cons that come with it, it kind of shed some clarity on it in terms of kind of what we've been talking about a lot in the past, and just, okay, yeah. Do you want to go to prom? Does every kid want to go to prom? Absolutely. Does every kid want to be a McDonald's kid? Absolutely. Does everybody want to be, you know, do the high school thing, the right, you know, the, you know, go for another state championship? Does everybody, you know, all of that stuff is all well and good. But I think when it comes down to it with Paolo, I think he's going to look at himself in the mirror and go, I am way too good to play another year in high school, and as much as I value the senior activities and all that stuff that I would get, and as much as I value being the number one player in the class of 2021, which he has told us on this podcast that he's actively looking to be the number one player in the class of 2021. Even with all of that stuff, I think at the end of the day, he's going to look at himself in the mirror and go, man, I can be one step closer to the NBA if I reclass. I can be 1 year away from the NBA if I make the jump. I just think at the end of the day, it's going to be too much to turn down. He's going to end up doing it. I'm just going to gun to my head. I'm going to say that's what he does. And yeah, I agree. I think they're going to probably go for a grad transfer first, knowing that Cliff is a guy they kind of have in their back pocket. I think Cliff is a guy that they can get at any stage if they really push hard for him, and that they're gonna explore their other options, knowing that Cliff is gonna decide kind of, you know, relatively last minute, and they'll go grad transfer in Paolo first, and then kind of see how it unfolds from there.
Hold on, real quick, note on Paolo, real quick. You were talking about how he said on here before that he wanted, one of his goals was to be the number one player in the 2021 class. He got closer to that yesterday as the new Rivals 150 came out for 2021, and Paolo is now up to second. He moved up from fourth to second, and Jonathan Kuminga is sitting in front of him at one. And everybody knows Jonathan Kuminga it's really on the table for him to go to college this upcoming year. So Paolo could be the de facto number one player when it's all said and done.
Yeah. 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 Very good point. David Wood asks, if Oklahoma State fires Boynton because of their terrible year so far and winless in the Big 12, do you think Coach Cal asks Cade if he wants to come to Kentucky then? He's going to. He'll ask.
The best player in high school basketball right now, arguably, I think that you men offenses there. I don't even know how the relationship is between Kentucky and their camp. But yeah, obviously, you take – because if you have Cade, B.J. Boston, and Terrence Clark on the team, you're speaking the 40-0 terms again.
Yeah. Yeah, 100%. Cade is the number – he jumped up to number one for a reason. He's the number one player in the class. In terms of pure dominance, he's that guy. But he signed, I will say that, so it's not going to be as easy. I know things get a little tricky when head coaches are fired and all that, but – I just don't see a scenario where they fire their head coach knowing that they have the number one player in the country coming next year. I think when Cade comes and if they have a nightmare season next year, that's when I think they start talking, you know, firing and all that. And unless notice of allegation comes and things get serious on that front, that's something that I think, you know, that'll kind of change the dynamic of it and all that. But as of today, I just don't see a scenario where Cade ends up back at Kentucky. I just don't. I think Calipari went all in on that opportunity, decided to, you know, they knew that they were able to get Devin Askew. They had him in their back pocket and said, screw it. Let's go for it. They came really, really close. I think they finished number two without even thinking twice. I think I'm certain that they came number two. It was a close second, but at the end of the day, he wanted to stay with family. And what are you going to do? Anything on Sky Clark or DJ Wagner from
– Hey, real quick on Cade, real quick.
Okay.
The Mike Boynton situation, I think, is much different than the Shaka Smart situation. I think there's a mutual understanding between Shaka Smart and Texas. And I think Shaka is just wanting a fresh start somewhere else. That's kind of some rumblings I've heard behind the scenes. But like you said, unless the NCAA comes down on Ohio State, they're not going to get rid of Boynton next year, knowing the media fiasco that's going to be surrounding Cade Cunningham, because that's the best thing that Oklahoma State has had since Barry Sanders.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a really good point. Like I said, David Wood asks, or Ethan G asks about anything on Sky Clark or DJ Wagner. I already talked about DJ Wagner. I think he is one of the best class of 2023 kids I've seen so far. He's a superstar in the making. I think he's 100% going to Kentucky. If he does go to college, he'll be a Wildcat. Travis, you've been all over the Sky Clark stuff. We've mentioned in the past that we're feeling pretty good about Kentucky's chances with that, but you know, kind of take that a step further. What makes you confident about Kentucky's chances with Sky?
Yeah, I've got a really good relationship with Sky's dad, Kenny. Me and him chop it up a lot. They are visiting. It kind of sucks for them. We were talking about this last night, me and Kenny were. It kind of sucks for them. They're visiting on the 10th, and they were going to visit for the Vanderbilt game tomorrow, but there was a scheduling conflict due to one of his games. So he rescheduled for February 10th, and there's not a game on that day. Oh, so yeah, they're still excited for it, of course, but UK has told them that, like, oh, it's just a completely different feel whenever there's a game going on. But, yeah, Sky, I feel great about Kentucky's chances. If Kentucky pushes for Sky hard, I think they get Sky either for 2021 or 2022. I think reclassification is definitely on the table for him. And as of right now, if you look at the guys UK's recruiting in the upcoming classes, Sky Clark, Jaden Hardy, et cetera, they're electric scorers. Sky's averaging 26 points through 23 games and has like 12 games. His dad said he's got like 12 games with 30 points or more. And this is in Southern California where it's stiff competition.
Yeah.
And Jaden Hardy's averaging, what were we saying, Jack?
Like 32 a game or something like that.
If Sky's your point guard and Jaden's your shooting guard, that's an electric scoring backcourt. Both natural scorers, built to score the basketball.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah. But, recruiting-wise, I feel great with UK's positioning with Sky Clark. They're just waiting on an offer now.
Yeah, I think that is something that they will be discussing on this visit, and I would not be surprised if UK pulls the trigger on that at all. Chase French asks, "What are the big question? What are UK's chances with Greg Brown now that Shaka Smart might be on his way out with Memphis losing plus not having any other recruits signed for next year? Is UK ahead of Auburn?" And then I think Walk 35 says this, along with Khalil leaving, Greg plays more wing and hybrid 3-4 anyway. We honestly need Greg and Cliff for real thoughts. So yeah, it kind of goes hand in hand. Those questions go together. I don't think that Texas is the leader anymore. I know some of the national guys have said that, but I can kind of continue that sentiment. I think that, and I'm not saying that they're not a contender. I still think that they are a very strong contender, but I think the writing's on the wall a little bit that Shaka might be there, might not be there. And I think his dad he's explicitly said in the past that if Shaka's not there, they will not be. So that's something that is definitely prominent in this situation. But I do think that Memphis is still in very, very strong position. What I will say is if Memphis doesn't land another top recruit, and I don't think that they're going to get Jalen Green anymore after my conversations at the HoopHall Classic with people close to him, I do not think that Memphis is going to land him. I think he is more likely to go either overseas or play for a school like in Oregon or something like that. I don't think USC is an option anymore either.
I've got a future cast in for him to Auburn.
I think Auburn is good, and that would really hurt if he ended up going to Auburn, because I think that would make it very enticing for Greg Brown to go to Auburn and play with Sharif Cooper and Jalen Green. So I think Kentucky fans need to root for Jalen Green to end up at a school. You know what? Kentucky fans just need to root for him to go overseas at this point. That would be the best scenario for Kentucky regarding A, he doesn't go to Memphis. B, he doesn't join, it doesn't spark, a reason for Greg Brown to go to Auburn or whatever. Him going overseas would kind of just allow him to, let other things fall into place, because I don't know if Greg Brown would want to go to a school like Auburn without another premier guard. Like, I know Sharif is phenomenal, but you get what I'm saying. I think that trio would be much more enticing than that duo. And I think
I'll say this. I'll disagree with you on the rooting for overseas ordeal, and I'll explain why. There is not one single player that is like Jalen Green in college basketball this year, and college basketball is solely missing players.
All right, that's fair.
And just like the electricity that he brings, just his dunks, is like he looks like a young Kobe out there sometimes, like at the same stage. And I hate saying that, rest in peace Kobe, 100%. But I've heard some scouts say he looks like a young Kobe, some ex-players say he looks like a young Kobe, and he's just scratching the surface. But yes, because I think right now, if I was handicapping it, and this could completely flip-flop throughout the next few weeks. I think Memphis leads for Greg Brown. Like I said, I've got a future cast in for Jalen Auburn. But I think that if Texas is out of the picture, then I think Auburn is second for Greg Brown and Kentucky's third. Kentucky could jump up to second, maybe even first, along the way. But as of right now, that's how I would handicap it. And, yeah, team featuring Sharif Cooper, Jalen Green, and Greg Brown would be absolutely terrifying.
I think that's a really good – I would say something that is really, really benefiting Kentucky in the timeline of all this is that Greg Brown has said over and over again he is not in a rush at all in terms of this, in this decision-making process. He will wait until the very, very last second to make a decision because he wants to see where other guys go. He wants to see who goes to the NBA. He wants to see transfers and all that. So if – like we were talking about, if Jalen goes to Oregon – or UCLA, whatever. If he goes elsewhere that's not Memphis or, you know, a school that Greg Brown's not going to, it could, you know, flip something for him and say, okay, maybe I want to go to a Kentucky where I can join elite talent.
And once again, I bring it back to if I think a lot of this stems on Mike Miller may very well be at Memphis next year, but I've heard a bunch of rumblings throughout the whole entire season that he might not be at Memphis. I've also heard rumblings this week that a lot of people are starting to view Memphis is a glorified AAU program. I don't know if that's enticing to Greg or what, but apparently their practices are just pickup half the time. Penny and Mike Miller play against them. It kills their confidence. So I think there's certain leaks where everything's just not peachy over there at Memphis.
You're exactly right, because I talked to at least one parent in particular that – was, you know, slightly involved with Memphis at least at one. I'm not going to say who, but was involved with Memphis at one point in time, and has very slowly basically said, yeah, this is it, you know, it's a circus. You know, he said shit show was the exact wording of it, but basically said that it was not going the way that they kind of anticipated it happen. And I know James Wiseman left, and it's kind of created a whole new dynamic of it, but it is not going the way that they anticipated. And the rumors of Mike Miller leaving after this year are 100% out there. And he is their lead recruit. I mean, he is a phenomenal recruiter. He's at every single event. Great, you know, really connects well with the players. So that would be a massive loss for them. And, you know, just the fact that the season is not going the way they planned, James Wiseman not sticking around, NCAA, you know, seemingly watching their every move. It's just a recipe that it could have worked in an ideal world if James Wiseman stuck around, blah, 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 blah. But I just don't see this unfolding in a positive way that they're not even in conversation with a lot of the elite guys for next year. I think Greg Brown and Jalen Green are the only two main guys that they're in on heavy, and it's, you know, there's a chance that they don't land either. So this whole experiment could end very, very poorly. It'll be a very interesting dynamic to see how it all unfolds in the coming months. Next question. Is there any other potential 2021 recruits who could reclass and join 2020 other than Banchero and Kuminga? That comes from Mick Cardell. Travis, what do you think? I know we've talked about Banchero and Kuminga loosely. You know, I don't know if either of us think that that's a realistic option that much at this point in time. But is there anybody else you've heard is an option?
Jaden Hardy will not be a reclassification candidate, according to his coach. Whenever I talked to him, like a few months ago, he said that Jaden wanted to be a 2020 kid. A lot of people talk about Musa Cisse possibly reclassifying, but then again, he's like 16.
Yeah.
I think he could definitely play. I think he'd be, but like I said, it comes down to age. I think the most realistic option, I don't think it's on the table. Like I talked about earlier, according to his guardian, is Frank Kepnang. But if you need like an option, if you get down like option E or F, like Kentucky's gotten to the past couple of years, whenever they struck out on their big men,
yeah,
I think Frank is a guy that you would definitely give a call to, because you know what you get from him when he's on the floor. You're gonna get defense, rebounding, and putbacks, and he gives you that automatically.
Yeah, I think Musa Diabate could potentially reclass, but I just don't know if Kentucky is a legitimate suitor for him.
I talked to his guardian. I want to say about a little over a month ago. It was a little bit before Christmas, and he was saying that, yeah, they're really looking at 2020, but UK hasn't reached out to them in regards to 2020.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and which if they're if which makes me think that they're feeling confident with other options if they're not going to reach out to him for 2020, because it, you know, a guy that says, yeah, I'm really interested in going and jumping a year, and they need option they need guys for that year. Why wouldn't they? So that's interesting. We will. I just don't see that as an option as of today. But we'll see in the coming months. Any more news on Brandon Huntley Hatfield reclass news, or just about the recruitment as a whole? That comes from Ethan Paul. I mentioned that a little bit before. I heard something while I was up at the Hoop Hall this weekend that made me think that Kentucky was the runaway favorite for Huntley Hatfield, no matter when he comes. And I do think he'll end up reclassing to 2021. But I did hear that Kentucky was feeling very, very, very good about their chances. And I think, I don't want to say it's a lock, but there are people on both sides of the aisle that are basically saying right now, like, yeah, we're going to go ahead and kind of pencil him in as a very, very, very serious option for them. So I would be I'd be relatively shocked if he ended up anywhere other than Kentucky at this point in time. I know it's still relatively early. You know, he's still a 2021. At best, he'll end up being a 2021 kid. So we have a whole year of news before he kind of takes that next step. So we'll see, but I feel very good about Kentucky's chances. Is that kind of what you're hearing about Huntley Hatfield?
Yeah, I've felt confident about UK's chances for a while. I think Ole Miss is a school that'll have a good shot with him. I think Memphis will be there, and I think Baylor will be there. I think those three, along with Kentucky, I would say are his top four. He hasn't been quoted as saying such, but if I were to handicap the race, those would be the four favorites. And I've been really teetering on putting in a future cast on Rivals for him to UK. But I just haven't pulled the trigger yet. I want to talk to a few more people and give it a few more months. But I've been thinking about it. So that tells you how serious I am about it.
Pull the plug. Do it. I dare
right now,
you.
The two players I have going to Kentucky. Here, let me pull up my future cast real quick. I've got Jaden Hardy. Future cast to Kentucky.
We will talk about him in a second.
I saw he started getting what are they called? Oh, the crystal balls on 24/7. He got an influx of them to Kentucky this year or this week. I mean, if DJ Wagner had an offer, I would give him. I would 100% give him a future cast. And whenever Scott Clark gets an offer, I will give him a future cast to UK as well.
I would agree with all of the above. Let's see. Matthew Zola, does Khalil Whitney's transfer impact anyone else? No. UK Shane, are there any news on Big Cliff? We need one more. We actually need two more. And like we said, I think Kentucky's in a great position if they actually want to be in great position. If they actively go after him, I think that they do get him. I just think that they feel pretty confident about other guys that are kind of higher up on their list. I wouldn't be shocked at all if he ended up in Kentucky's recruiting class. I just think it all depends on how it all unfolds with some of the other guys a little higher ranked and in the class of 2021. And potentially, you know, if a guy like Kerry Blackshear comes along, they're obviously going to favor that elite grad transfer as well. Tyler Harris, any updates on Greg Brown or Sharif O'Neal? We talked about Greg Brown, but I will say Sharif O'Neal, he was a guy that I think Kentucky would have been able to lock up instantly last year if they actively recruited him and really wanted him. When he was a recruit, or I guess that was 2 years ago at this point. I can't remember when exactly. Yeah, I guess it'd be 2 years ago. When he decommitted from Arizona, Kentucky 100% had the opportunity to get him. They did not go after him at all. And you know, after his heart issues and some of that, you know, it sucks for the kid because, you know, that's very serious, but I just don't know if that's a risk that Kentucky wants to take. You know, maybe it's a guy that they go, shoot, we have all these extra roster spots. We brought on a baseball player, for goodness sake. Why the hell would we not bring on Shaq's son? But I just don't see that being an ideal match for right now. Travis, do you think that's a possibility?
No, I would give it a 99% chance that he doesn't end up at Kentucky. A couple schools I've seen float around are Michigan, which I don't know about their scholarship situation right now, because I know right now I have them probably adding Josh Christopher as well. I agree. And they've already got a loaded class plus a lot of returnees. And I've heard Houston mentioned by a couple people, but I don't really have any inside information with that. That's just name or schools that have been thrown around.
I will say, if Isaiah Todd goes pro, I would pencil in Sharif O'Neal.
That's a great point.
With that class, because that, I mean, it'd be a that's something that, like, Juwan Howard would be 100% desperate to get a guy like Shaq's son to, you know, because of what Isaiah Todd's going to bring to the table, at least in terms of just fan interest. Think of, you know, they'll be missing out on that if he goes pro, but they could easily get that with a guy like Shaq's son. You know, I think that would be. I think that would be a solid match. But yeah, the initial rumblings before he even announced his transfer were that he was planning on joining Josh Christopher and Isaiah Todd up in Michigan. So we will see how that unfolds, but I do not see Kentucky being the landing spot. Jacob McKinney asks, all the Kuminga news you have, please. That's kind of a loaded question. But I am starting to operate under the assumption that he's kind of a Duke lock at this point. It kind of sucks because I think he is the number one guy in the nation, regardless of class. I think he brings a lot to the table. That UK could desperately use. I just think that Kentucky's still going to pursue. They're still visiting him several times. They still think that they have a shot, but some of the speculation behind the scenes is that Duke has made up significant ground and that they've kind of established itself as the favorite at this point. So I'm going to go ahead and say no at this point.
Duke there for a while seemed to fade because they kind of pushed for a commitment, never got it. And they're like, all right, well, we're not going to waste our time. We're going to take these other guys. And now it's like, I'm hearing from a couple different people that nobody really knows for certain, cause they keep it tight-lipped like David Sisk has talked about. But I've heard a couple of people that would know they're close to Jonathan that, if Duke has the roster spot, which you 1,000% make a roster spot for a dude like Kuminga, I don't care if you tell your worst player he's going off scholarship, you make room for Kuminga, that he would be a Duke lock.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's like telling Cade, sorry, man, we took a commitment from whoever. Like, yeah, sorry, we can't do that. We got to turn you down. It's like, no. If a guy like Jonathan Kuminga opens, says, hey, I want to come down, there's no way you say no. I think that was just a dumb decision on their part. And I think they're starting to slowly realize how dumb of a decision it was, because it seems like they are picking up a little bit of the momentum with it. I still wouldn't be surprised if LSU is a serious, and I'm not saying that Kentucky is out of it at all. I still think that they're a top.
Texas Tech also.
Yeah. I'd say Kentucky with LSU, Duke, and Texas Tech, I'd say that those are kind of the top four.
I've heard
top
Auburn
four
as
options.
Well. I've heard Auburn. Yeah. Is very high up on his list. And yeah. Good God, dude. If the people that we mentioned earlier,
no
possibly going to Auburn, if you act Kuminga to that, Jesus
let's
Christ.
Let's not even go down that path, because that would be absolutely filthy. And I just don't even want to entertain a scenario where that happens. Justin Tucker. Is Jaden Hardy the next big superstar with guys like Zion, John Wall, AD, and Andrew Wiggins? Well, while we're talking about Hardy, let's talk about his recruitment and just who he is as a player. So, Travis, what were you saying?
Well, in terms of the question about star power, I don't think he's going to possess the type of star power that Zion has, or these other guys that are bigger frame guys that just rip down the rim every single time. And I think the perfect player comparison for Jaden Hardy is Bradley Beal.
Yep.
I think he's Bradley Beal with a higher college ceiling, because he was better than Bradley Beal at this stage, in my opinion. I think he scores the ball from all three levels better than Bradley did, and he would be the best scorer coming out of high school that Cal's arguably ever had at Kentucky.
I'm telling you, when I saw Jaden in person out in Vegas, I was like, there is no doubt in my mind Kentucky has to get this kid. Like, has to get this kid. And as of what, you know, everything I've heard, I think, you know, Kentucky, we talked about Kentucky picking up Cristobal picks and all that. But I mentioned on the podcast when I met with Jaden out in Vegas, when I saw him watch Kentucky practice, you know, sat with his coach, sat with his dad. After that meeting, I came away thinking there is no way in hell he ends up anywhere other than Kentucky. Everyone that I talked to, everything that I saw with my own two eyes, everything told me this is 100% gonna be Kentucky. So, you know, is Bradley Beal was a five-star kid coming out of high school when he signed with Florida. He was a superstar for Florida. He was a lottery pick at Florida for that reason. Or I guess, what didn't he go number three? Wasn't he a top three pick? I'm pretty certain he was a top three pick to the Wizards. But no matter how, you know, how that unfolded, that is, you know, that's a great player comp, and Bradley Beal was a star, and I think Jaden Hardy would be a star at Kentucky. So it just depends on your definition of a star. Is he is he Zion level? I wouldn't say so, but I, you know, there's still something to be said to be a guy like Bradley Beal, to be a top five level draft pick. Like, I think he would be better than Tyrese Maxey is right now. I think he'd be better than I think he'd put up numbers like what Malik Monk did, maybe even you know that level of just being able to flat out put the ball in the hoop from anywhere on the floor. That is who Jaden Hardy is. So it just depends on your definition of superstar. If you think that is a superstar, a guy that, you know, was Malik Monk a superstar in your eyes? Maybe. I mean, it just depends on your definition. I don't think he'll be Zion level.
I don't think he'll garner the national attention somebody like Zion did, but I think he'll be a fantastic. Do you consider somebody like Jamal Murray a superstar?
Yeah.
I hate comparing him, but like somebody that fills it up, like a Steph Curry was a superstar.
Yeah.
Granted, I'm not comparing him to the best shooter that's ever played the game, but they impact the game, and they're superstars in their own right that don't garner national attention.
Yeah, but yeah, we both feel very, very confident about Kentucky's chances with Jaden Hardy, and you should too. With the guys, and we're wrapping up here real quick. I know Travis, you got to get out of here as well. With the guys coming in, where do you think shooting falls in their skill set, and who needs to stay to fill the lowest skill set need? Okay, that's an interesting question. That came from the transaction.
Can I go ahead and answer the one that needs to stay?
Yes.
Senior Nick Richards.
Oh God, not happening. But yes, that would just completely
on the fence, guys. You can make an argument for EJ Montgomery, but I think Emmanuel Quickly would take the cake for me.
Yeah, Emmanuel, guys like, you know, Johnny Juzang. I think what's really interesting is I'm secretly hoping out of Keon Brooks and Johnny Juzang. This is very selfish of me, but with Khalil's transfer, I'm almost nervous that one of them is going to click, because, you know, we, this whole season we've been penciling in both at least one of Keon and Khalil to return, and Johnny to return, well, you know, almost certainly. And we've been kind of talking about Emmanuel as a potential draft guy, but we still kind of been under the assumption that we, if we had to put money on it, we'd probably lean him returning. But selfishly, I'm kind of worried that one of Keon or Johnny is going to like magically click and things are going to all, you know, work and they're going to start playing out of their mind, and we're only going to get about, you know, a quarter of the season, maybe I guess you could say a third of the season or so of elite play out of them, and then one of them is going to go to the NBA after one season. That's kind of my that would not be an ideal scenario. It'd be great for this season, but because of me already penciling in for next year, it would kind of be a little bit of a disappointment.
I'll say this: everybody before this season was talking about EJ Montgomery taking a PJ Washington type second-year jump, which I never believed just because of his personality, and they're two totally different players. Somebody I think that could make an awesome sophomore year jump is Keon Brooks.
I think
he could be absolutely
awesome.
Fantastic as a small ball four next year. Once he figures out defense and rebounding consistently and gets his motor going consistently, gets caught up to the full speed of the game, I think I think he's going to be a complete mismatch if UK wants to run and gun next year.
And to finish that question with the guys coming in, who are the best shooters? Easily, Devin Askew is the guy. I mean, he's a plus 40% shooter in AAU ball. He's a guy that if you leave him open, he's going to knock down shots. Like I mentioned earlier, he's at modern day. He is the go-to superstar on the team. So he kind of, you know, people watch him closer than some of his teammates. With BJ Boston and Terrence Clark, and if they get another superstar in the front court or however that unfolds, he's going to be your guy that you look at as a knockdown shooter. If Emmanuel Quigley comes back, that's those two together are going to be just absolutely nasty. BJ Boston has really, really impressed me as a shooter. Terrence Clark's been a little bit inefficient as a shooter, but he can at least be a serviceable guy. And of course, Johnny Juzang, I think that's going to be another knockdown guy if he kind of stays on the track that he is on right now. But yeah. Anybody else that you're thinking of?
If everybody returns that should return next year and everybody shoots to almost all their capability, I think UK's team next year could be one of the best shooting teams the Cal's had here. Do you think you would have Devin Askew, who shoots 47% in EYBL? You have Emmanuel Quickley. Everybody knows what he's been doing this year. BJ Boston. And all these players, the high school players, are the number one option on their team. And granted, BJ plays on a loaded team, but people get to key in on Terrence, and Terrence is initiating the offense a lot. If Terrence is playing off ball and he's not 100% the other team's defense priority, I think he can shoot 35%. Keon Brooks, I think, can shoot 30%. Johnny Juzang, I think, his best capability, I think he's a 40% three-point shooter.
Yeah, I completely agree.
And I don't think you'll see that this year because I still think he's trying to find his college legs. But I think if he returns next year, I think it has the possibility of being a great shooting team. And, my God, if you had a guy like Paulo who can stretch the floor too at the five spot.
Oh, man, they'd be nasty. Absolutely nasty. Well, we went through all of our questions, so I think we can end it there. Travis, you have anything else you want to add?
No, not right now. I'm going to talk to a couple of recruiting circles this week and hopefully have some intel for you guys next week.
Yeah, this week I'm going to try to put together either if we can't get Terrence Clark on next week, I'm going to put something together. We're gonna get a big time guest next week, and we'll put together a pretty awesome show. So with that, Travis, where can they find your work and on social media?
You can find me on Twitter at Trav_Graf. You can find my other podcast on all the podcast outlets. It's called the Cat Scan Podcast with a K. You can find it on Twitter at CatScanPod. You can find David Sisk on Twitter at Coach David Sisk. And you can find both of our work on Cats Illustrated on the Rivals Network.
And you can find me at JackPilgrimKSR. If you want to reach out for any sponsorship opportunities, you can find me there or via email at jpilgrim@kentuckysportsradio.com. And with that, we will be back next week for another jam-packed Sources Say podcast, and we will see you then.